hello everyone, good afternoon. Today, I think this is the third time I am speaking to this. The audience might be new here, but the organizers, Renaissance, and Shrijit is responsible to get me here again for the third time. So I'm happy to be here and share some of my thoughts with all of you. So today I'll discuss with you what we understand or what we might be thinking about religion as a key social factor in deciding public health issues. And usually when we think about religion, the connection of the religion with health is one entity which actually does not present itself to the scrutiny of the public, because somehow we consider religion as an entity which does not require any scrutiny, and it is above our realm of skepticism, or what do we say, policing. And therefore, unlike other areas of inquiry, the inquisitiveness or the purpose of inquiry does not apply to religion. And therefore, that also we see that in the area of public health, that is people's health issues, we don't really give that much importance to how religion might be connected with the health problems of the community. So if we look at religion, medicine and healthcare have been related in one way or the other throughout the documented history. We can see that religion, medicine and healthcare are interlinked with each other. Only in recent times it is seen that the healthcare or the health sciences has departed from the authority of religion, because it was the religious authorities and the institutions which were prescribing what to do when individuals fall sick. And it was, you take any part of the world, globe, whether it is the Christianity or Western continents or here in the Eastern philosophies, it was the missionaries or the priests who were prescribing some of the remedies for diseases and disorders of the human population. So it was, that demarcation came only recently, and today we see a clear demarcation between health sciences and religion in developed countries. But in many of the developing countries, including India, we don't see that kind of a clear demarcation even today. So, for example, if you take life expectancy of individuals, life expectancy at birth is one of the most frequently used summary measure of health. Actually, if you want to know the health of the people of a country, we take a broader indicator, that is life expectancy at birth. If a country's life expectancy at birth is this and this, it gives a summary of how is this health condition of the people in that country. So if we look at that, then we also see that you can use that to quantify the health dimension of your health development indices, which are used by these governments, both at the state level as well as at the center, and even the bilateral, multilateral agencies like United Nations or WHO uses this particular dimension. So that is why I decided that I'll take this particular dimension, that is life expectancy at birth, to give us a picture about, to make us understand how religion and health connection could be there. So before I discuss that aspect directly, first, let's just try to understand how this concept of religion came about. And of course, as we all know, I'm talking about the origin of the word religion. If you look at in ancient Greek we come across the word treske, which refers to observances of cult prescriptions. So whatever the description of you give for a cult, that was basically referred to as during the ancient Greek. But in the classical Greek, any term which describes the religion as of now we understand does not appear. It came only late during the 1st century BC, where we see terminologies designating religion as a complex of beliefs and practices. So there is a longer dispute over the origin of this Latin word religio. Even today the dispute is there. If you look at these two particular terms, religare and religio, we will be able to understand some of the concepts which exist even today. If you look at the word religare, it means to collect again, to take up again for a new choice, to return to a previous synthesis in order to recompose it. Basically what it means is an area of self-introspection through the process of self-awareness. That what you mean by the term religare, which had helped originate this concept of religion. So if you come to even our Eastern philosophies, religion in its original form referred to our own internal journey within ourselves to understand the meaning and morals of life. So it was not basically attached to any organized cult like institutional understanding of religion, which is explained by this Latin word religio, which means obligation, an objective bond between the believer and his or her God. That's what now the organized religion and most commonly the mainstream meaning of religion, what it means now is this. That is, it is no more subjective in nature. It is objective, and whatever is your God, depending on in which religion you are born into, if you want to have a direct bond with him or her, you need to just follow certain prescriptions, and it does not just remain at the belief system. It extends to a set of practices which we just follow in the name of tradition. So it comes down to the level where our thinking faculty, especially the critical thinking faculty of our brains, stop functioning and we just blindly follow certain sets of principles. So that is what now in today's discussion with you people, I'll be referring to that form of religion, not the other idea of religion which steps into kind of spirituality. Now we know that the word spirituality has also been contaminated extensively. So even if I take the word spirituality, it means pseudoscience, superstition and all of those things, and these gurus which in the name of superstition make a lot of money. So I'm not referring to that point here. Anyways, my discussion today's topic with you people, with all of us, is about the commonly held notion of religion as an organized institution and how it prescribes a cult like set of beliefs and prescriptions which all of us as human societies have been unconsciously or consciously we have been following. So superstition also comes here, and we all know superstition is something which is if you hold a belief which is unfounded or irrational, which cannot be interpreted by scientific reasoning, it is called superstition. But religion itself is the biggest superstition humans have invented, because if you start interpreting religion, the organized religion which I tried my best to share with you the concepts of, falls into this area of irrationality. But human behaviors have been shaped in society, whether we agree with it or not, by these religious or superstitious prescriptions. And therefore, even health behaviors, people's behavior towards their health, are also shaped by this entity which is having a very tight hold on societies. So public health cannot shy away from understanding or exploring religions hold on our health seeking behavior or health behaviors of the population. So there is a direct link. And in India, when we talk about religion, we should not avoid or shy away from talking about the reality of our Indian society, which is the caste system. Caste and religion are interlinked, and caste system through social stratification produces social exclusion by imposing social restrictions on groups of people just based on in which caste you have been accidentally born into. And that inextricable link between these two act as a proxy to socio-economic status in India. So we should always be very cognizant of the fact that you cannot explore health issues of the people just based on socio-economic status. Because in India, caste and religion are the deciding key social factors for your socio-economic status. So we need to look at the public health problem from this lens as well. So let's just explore some of the examples affecting health. See, very common simple examples I have put here. See, we say at home, they say, you know, don't sleep with your head facing north because it's not good for health. Women are not allowed to enter kitchen or go to temples or puja, you know, that part of the place in your house because they are considered impure and unclean. Dead person's family should not cook food until that kriya, that tithi ceremony, what we do, that's because it's believed it's harmful for family. Other things like when you go and attend that funeral, you should come back and wash yourself, take bath because of all these superstitious beliefs. And of course, for each of these, they give scientific reasons. Because that word scientific is so much abused. Like every person holding to be an expert uses that word. Examples which are in related to pregnancy and newborn, it's really alarming, and even today it exists in our societies. So pregnant women are not allowed to go out during eclipse because it brings bad luck to the baby or deformities to the baby. Not eating papaya during pregnancy because it is too much here, you know, hot. That fruit is very hot. It causes abortions and other things. Consuming ghee during pregnancy eases delivery. Not giving colostrum to newborn, the first milk, it's because it reduces baby's immunity. Even today, many people follow this. In fact, it should be the reverse of it. You should never deprive the newborn with colostrum because it boosts the newborn's immunity. Giving sugar or honey to newborn before breastfeeding. The medical fraternity says a big no to this. Up to 6 months, you should not feed your baby with anything. Why they do this? They think it makes baby's life sweet. Not giving bath to newborn baby because it may lower baby's temperature, not good for health. And all, you know, the contradictions which we see here. Not keeping newborn and mother's clothes outside after sunset because someone may do black magic. In Karnataka, there is a community called Kadugola community near Dharwad, Davangere, and Kolar district also, I think it comes near that. There, as soon as you deliver the baby, the lactating mother and the newborn will be pushed outside the house. And they have to reside outside the house. They'll just keep her outside. If it is hot sun or if it's raining, they'll be outside. So these are all some of the irrational behaviors which directly affect the health of the newborn as well as the mother. Let's look at some of the examples which influence our health-seeking behavior. There are some studies which have tried to understand health-seeking behavior from religion's lens. There are many studies which have explored health-seeking behavior in India, but when it comes to looking at it through the religion lens, there are quite a few. And I have taken this from one of these studies. See, we usually see poor utilization of healthcare facility, and especially in those areas which have these pockets of tribal population, because primary health care is not accessible even today in India to at grassroots level to each and every last standing person in the society. For them, the more accessible people are the local quacks, traditional healers, many of whom may not know scientific methods of curing diseases or taking care of the health. But they are more easily accessible for marginalized societies because the other modern healthcare facilities are not made accessible to them. The primary healthcare system is, even today they have to come to cities like Bengaluru or Chennai for tertiary care or curative services. Illness is God's wish. They think that when in this particular study, when they ask these people, what do you think about your illness? They strongly believe that illness is God's wish. So if God wishes that you need to fall ill, nobody can do anything about it. Even hospitals or experts in the hospital cannot do anything. Disease is always caused by hostile spirits, ghosts, or maybe you have violated a taboo in your society. That's why God is punishing. So it's the curse of God. And it happens in, I think, all of our, not just in tribal communities. Why do you do in your house Satyanarayana Puja and all this, Homa and Havanas to ward off the evil effects on, you know, including health. These are included. Because we still believe that there are some hostile spirits and you have to pacify either these spirits or gods in order to escape from, you know, the. So there is an easy remedy for everything. Mr. Ravana is doing whole full day Homa Havana at home, it seems. Why? Whatever heinous crimes you committed now do not matter because you can just ask forgiveness from the spirits or from the God. So, of course, we have to address these behavior issues if we want to address the gap religion poses. Here, why I took these examples is to show that people's health is also under the influence of our religious belief systems and practices. And interestingly, mental health is one area in people's health, in public health, which is very interestingly was for a long period of time in the hold of monasteries and religious communities. They were taking care of these mentally ill people. Even today, if you go to rural areas and maybe even in the urban areas, in urban poor pockets, mental illnesses are equated with ghosts arriving in you. And maybe sometimes gods also come in your soul and they have occupied you. And we, as people, go and find solace with priests in the temple and we tie all those, this thing to ward off. And especially among women, we see mental health issues, which we, even today, going to a psychiatrist and taking counseling is considered as a taboo, irrespective of any socioeconomic strata. It's not just among the poor. Even among middle class and upper middle class and upper class, we haven't yet come out of that taboo, because that's how strong the hold of religion on our consciousness. So it was in the early period, in the hands of the religious community, and that's how we see that they became famous for inhuman treatment of the mentally ill, who are often chained, dunked in water, or beaten. And that's why we talk about these mental hospitals. The picture we get even today is that kind of thing. Even in cinemas, they show like that. So, and during that time, it was William Tuke, who was a Quaker. Quaker is an outshoot of Christianity, which they just believe in the inner exploration of the mind. And they are released from all the ministry and the set of Christian rules. So it's an outshoot from the Christianity. And they just, William Tuke, first started what is called moral treatment, and not to beat them and all those things. And that gave rise to this new approach to looking at mental health aspect of the population. And Sigmund Freud, we all know, he is credited with bringing scientific methodology into understanding the mental disorders among humans. Throughout his work, if you look at all these four of his works, he has emphasized on how you should separate religion from taking care of mentally health, mentally, in order to first understand human's mind, first of all. Religious acts and obsessive practices, psychoanalysis and religion, future of an illusion, Moses and monotheism, all of these. He is the one who set that path apart, and mental health as of now today has taken a scientific route. But if you look at even today in the mental health research areas, studies exploring the relationship between religious involvement and severe mental disorders are not done much, because even among the researchers there is a taboo that we should not enter that area and disturb the religious mindset of the mainstream society. So not much studies have actually looked at the direct link between religious practices and their implications on mental disorders. So when we look at public health, that means people's health, religion becomes a determinant, and in India caste and religion act as a plexus, and estimates of mortality is the death rate, and longevity also, how long you live, these are not linked to socioeconomic status in India. In fact, they are linked to in which caste you are born. That may decide your socioeconomic status. It's very superficial when somebody says, if you are poor, you are responsible for it because you are not working hard. You know, I see those advertisements which come in the Twitter timeline. It's your, laziness that you are still remaining poor. It's such a superficial, irresponsible and inhuman statement to be made, because it's not that simple. And we don't decide where we are born, in which region of the country or the globe you are born actually decides your socioeconomic status. And in India, if you are born, in which caste system you are born, in which religion you are born. Even in India, religions, of course, we may have these three main religions like Muslim, Christians and Hindus. Even among Christians and Hindus, you have caste systems, because most of them are converted. Christians or converted Muslims from this many caste systems. We don't have something called Hindu religion as such, right? It's just a conglomeration of thousands of castes living together, coexisting together harmoniously. But unfortunately, we are seeing the demarcation, the kind of chisels in that harmony in our society lately. So from the discrimination, to escape the discrimination in the caste system of this so-called Hindu religion, thousands of them have now been, long time back, converted into either Muslims or Christians. So even among those communities in India, caste system exists. So we cannot look at Indian context just as a total demarcation between religions. So caste is a very glaring reality in front of us. And again, here, if you look at literature review, only in 2020 we see the first ever study which looked at life expectancy at birth across religion and caste in India. Only in 2020, that's what I've quoted here, Kumari M. and Mohanty SK in 2020 published a study which looked at the estimates of life expectancy by caste, religion and region in India. So you can imagine how protected that concept is. We are so scared. It's like a taboo to touch that area. And it does not remain just in the fields of, social sciences or anything. It is true even in public health. Okay, because I come from the public health area, so I'm talking about that. So there are some studies which have explored how caste has impacted health. But before we look at some of those studies, health, education and employment in India, we know that they vary by social and economic groups. These are the four major caste groups we can divide our Indian population into. Social, I mean, scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, other backward classes, and all the rest of the upper caste, they fall into others. So majority of the Indian population constituted by the first three category. We should not just look at ourselves in our peer group and think India is like this. That is a very irresponsible of us, especially those who are privileged. If we are privileged, it means to say that we should work and make use of our privilege for those who are not privileged, not just boast about our privilege. When these are the few studies, very few studies which look at caste. See, Patel in Bihar did a study in 2018, which was published then, explains that scheduled caste women are inequitably served with maternal health services. Of course, government has mother and child health services at PHC, primary health centers levels, but scheduled caste women are inequitably able to access these, and many times they experience discrimination when they are accessing these services at the hospitals. And these studies by these three sets of researchers, some of these points I have taken up. See, you see low health status observed among poor, female, rural, and specific minority groups of scheduled caste and scheduled castes. Lower caste women reported a higher prevalence of poorer health than women of higher castes. And if you look at life expectancy at 60 years, we see that general caste group, they live better. They live almost an average of 2 years better or more than SCST OBC groups. And if you look at life expectancy at birth, you see that it is highest among Christians in Indian population. These are all based on National Family Health Survey data, which is done by central government. Based on the NFHS data, they have assessed this. So it is highest among Christians, followed by others, and then Muslims, and then Hindus. Usually the perception is very poor health status among, I mean, they may die early, we may think, and we may boast of Hindus being very good at everything and all those things. But data shows differently, because when we categorize Hindus, remember we have scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other backward classes, which constitute most probably more than 70-80% of the population. So we have so much of inadequacies and areas which we have to introspect, but we overlook all these areas. The gap in life expectancy at birth between Christians and Hindus was 3 years. That means 3 years more they lived than us. It was low in the central region compared to western region, okay? And if you look at adult mortality, that is about 20 years, below 59 years, and premature mortality, it was highest among scheduled caste people. And if you look at the sex differences, it cuts across the caste, religion, and region. You will see that because of the biological reasons, women live longer than men, but how do they live is the picture we have to see. Though women live longer, they have higher morbidity, that is diseases, and disability at later ages. That is, their quality of life is not good, though they may live longer because of the biological reasons. And across religious groups, if you take adult death, again adult mortality I'm talking about, it's higher among Hindus than Muslims. So in adult age group, death is more among the Hindus. Premature deaths among Muslims was higher than among Christians. The explanation which was given was that though they may live longer, but if they are affected by disease, they have less accessibility to healthcare services. So they may not have accessibility issue, and affordability also, and they may die early if they have diseases. So to conclude my session, I want to reiterate that caste and religion are very interlinked areas, in especially in Indian context, and through social stratification and imposing social restrictions, causing social exclusions for majority of the population in India, it is a greater risk factor for people's health, that is public health. And remember, it is a proxy for socioeconomic status in India. You cannot directly assess the link between socioeconomic status and health unless you also look at the role of caste and religion playing there. So what challenges we have in front of us is to address this issue of caste and religion. And of course, in India, post-independence, all our national policies, economic policies or health policies, caste and religion have been central to these policies. That's why we have many of these schemes which are there to address this. But the challenges are the benefits of caste-based employment, education and health schemes are largely availed by better off within those deprived caste group. So that's a challenge, and as a result, the average in those classes themselves remained low, and poor are getting poorer, and especially now because of the very inadequately, inefficiently implemented economic policies, we are pushing the poorer into extreme poverty. And I think this audience knows best about what's happening with the inequality in wealth right now in our Indian population. So we should also think about existential risks for humanity in Indian context. What happens to these majority of the people in a country like India when you are tackling with vulnerabilities caused due to climate change? Because these are the people who are more vulnerable to climate change. Remember, the poor, the marginalized section of the society in a developing nation are not the reason for causing climate change, but they will bear the most burden of the effects of climate change. Who are the ones who, for example, when coastal areas are flooded, it's the marginalized poor families which bear the brunt of the flooding. And who were they causing, contributing to greenhouse gas emissions majorly? No. So maybe developed nations are causing more than developing nations. If you look at the per capita contribution of greenhouse gases, it's really very, very, very minimal in a country like India. But we bear the most burden. So we should really keep in mind of this when it comes to dealing with public health problems faced by climate change, AI again, and nuclear bombs. These are all things where the most burden faced are these groups of people. So health people who are academicians or researchers in public health also should keep this consciously in mind to look at this from the lens of caste and religion. So as a solution, this evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould proposed this concept, theory. He said that let's think that science encompasses the domain of facts about universe, while religion deals with the realm of meaning and moral values. So, isn't that a compromise we can accept? Well, forget about you and me, common people. Even the theologians did not agree with it, because what Gould did was he imposed limitations of religion for moral and about the universe. He said in his proposition, let science take care of the proceedings of the universe. The theologians do not agree with it. So they disagree that why should science look at it? Why are you limiting us only to morals and values? So they rejected it. And when you look at philosophers, they also rejected Gould's idea that meaning, morals and values are the purview of religion. So if you look at the secular humanism theory in philosophy, beginning with the ancient Greeks and passing through Kant, John Stuart Mill, and Hume to contemporary thinkers of today's like Peter Singer, philosophers do not say that they should be confined only to the universe and how it came about. We also have questions about morals and values, and we have, you know, evolutionary philosopher, evolutionary biologists and philosophers. They all share the dialogues and ideas, and together it's all multidisciplinary. So thus that proposition noma is ineffective on both fronts. So both of them did not agree. So who are we to, we don't have to compromise on that, because it does not really satisfy that we can just demarcate and they will take care of morals and values, and scientists will or philosophers will take care of how the universe came about. So I would just like to say that let's not shy away from discussing and talking about the role of caste system in people's health. And when politicians talk about these issues directly in their political campaigns, let's endorse it, because it should become an issue, a voting issue actually. Health should be an electoral issue. In developing countries like India, health has not taken the main narrative which can decide the polls. But I think it is high time that we should make it a mainstream narrative, especially during the season of elections. If health can be an electoral narrative which can make politicians submit to our demands on public health, on people's health. I'm not talking about that luxury healthcare which maybe you and I are having the privilege to access to. It's the people's health issues we are discussing here. And it's the any government's responsibility to take care of people's health. And even today in Indian Constitution, we don't have health as a human right there. Right to life, through the right to life, we also include health when we talk about, I think, through Article 21 and 14, these. So I think this is high time, and we should not shy away from talking about the influence of caste and religion, because most of the population of a country like India, especially India, because we have this unique system called caste system, which we cannot be proud about. And especially if you are privileged, born into privileged caste, please talk about it, because the privilege gives you that power to talk. So make use of that privilege and talk more about this in whichever areas you're working in. Try to see if you can bring that into your area of work, both in your personal lives as well as in public life. Thank you. Thank you so much.